Hallelujah and blessings in Jesus, friends. Welcome back to High Kadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life. Jesus is truly King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Holy Bible, praise God, is our only standard and authority for truth. And together God's people say, Hallelujah. Well, friends, today is February the 28th in the year of our Lord, 2018. And this is One a Day for the Soul. Now, we're continuing our journey through the story of the Bible, and today we are going to conclude the book of Joshua. Now, you may say, Pastor, you really went through that book awful fast. Well, if you've read the book of Joshua, you know the majority of it is spent and focused upon the conquest of Canaan. And so we're going to just say that Joshua has been conquering different cities throughout the land of Canaan, and the people of Israel have now taken it for themselves, meaning that they are no longer wanderers. They are no longer strangers. They are no longer unsettled. They have come into the promised land, and now it is of utmost importance that they cling to God, that they adhere to his truth, they obey his laws and his commandments, as both Moses gave them and Joshua himself has given them. Now, we, of course, have seen a whole new generation come to the forefront, because the old generation that was alive when Moses was alive, they're all dead and gone. And so here is a new people that know the law of God, they know the word of God, and they're about to lose their leader. And that's where we're going to pick up in Joshua chapter 23, and we're going to move through to the end of Joshua's death. But I want to focus on the heart of the ministry of Joshua. As a great leader, it seems like maybe the focus of the people would be looking to him as a great general who has been leading them in battle, but even more so, they look to him as a spiritual leader, the voice of God, their intercessor, their intermediary, the one who stands between them and God. And they're about to lose that person, and they're going to be lost without him. And this is why their hearts are going to cry out for a king eventually, and we'll discuss that in future videos. But let's begin today in Joshua chapter 23. And in my Bible, it says Joshua's address to Israel. You could pretty much say this is his last address to Israel. Now, we're just going to focus on the key points where Joshua gives his most important thoughts to the people. He knows that he's about to leave. And so, obviously, whatever he has to say is of utmost importance. And so he says in verse 6 of chapter 23, "Be ye therefore very courageous." Now remember, that's how he began his leadership. God told him at the beginning, when he was about to take the place of Moses, "Be courageous, Joshua." And so Joshua is telling the same to the people. Be courageous. Why? Because you are a great and mighty army? No, because God is on your side. Hallelujah. So be courageous and keep to do all. A-L-L. That means everything. You can't just do a little bit and not the rest. Keep all that is written in the book of the law of Moses. Now at this point, they didn't have everything that we have from Joshua moving forward in the Old Testament. And of course, they didn't have the New Testament. All they had was the writings of Moses. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. But friends, that is enough, because all the law of God is contained therein. And so Joshua says, be fervent, be zealous, be dedicated and committed to do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses. Do not turn aside from the right hand or to the left. Now, as we read this, friends, even though this was instruction given from Joshua to his beloved people thousands of years ago, we can take the same advice today. Be careful to do all that is within the law of God. And for us, we have even more clarity on the law of God because we have from Genesis to Revelation. We know the beginning of the story, praise God. We know the end of the story, praise God. We see the life of Jesus, the work of Jesus, what he accomplished on the cross. We understand the inner workings of the Holy Spirit in the lives of the followers of Jesus. And so we have so much more than they had. And yet we would have to ask ourselves the question, do we spend as much time dedicated to the Word of God as they might had? He says in verse 8, cleave unto the Lord your God. Now, when this says cleave, I can't help but have a picture in my mind of a small child who is just clinging to the leg of their parent. And that's what the Bible is telling us here. We are to cleave unto God, to squeeze tight, resisting all desire to let go. And take good heed in verse 11, therefore unto yourselves that you love the Lord your God. He says in chapter 24, now therefore, fear the Lord. You know, it would be an interesting study for you to go through and see how many times the Bible says, fear the Lord. I remember seeing quite some time ago on Facebook a banner, and it basically said that the Bible has 365 times when it says, love God or God loves you. And they were relating that to the days of the year so that for every day of the year, you can take comfort that God loves you. But we know as students of the Bible, God only loves those who seek to obey Him and follow His will. Psalm chapter 5 verse 5, Psalm 11 verse 5, both speak very clearly that God hates the unrighteous. We are told in Psalm chapter 7, verse 11, God judges the righteous, and He is angry with the wicked every day. In Psalm 11, 5, as I just referred to, it says that God hates the wicked and he who loves violence. And then Psalm chapter 5, verse 5 says, God hates all workers of iniquity. So don't be swept away into this idea that we're all God's children and God loves us all. He offers His love unto us all. But God is angry with the wicked every day, and He does not love them until they surrender to His will. But if you were to do that study, as I mentioned, of how many times the Bible says, fear the Lord, it's twice as many times as it speaks of the love of God. And so that would indicate to us that we are to fear God is more important than we are to love God. I mean, Jesus Himself said, fear not man, nor anything that man can do unto you, but fear God who is able to cast your soul into hell. We are told in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 18, if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? And what that tells us is that we are worthy, we deserve, we have earned eternity in hell, but we have scarcely been saved. And if our righteousness hangs upon such a thin thread, then certainly we are to fear God in the way that we live our lives. But then he continues in verse 14, fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and in truth. And this means with a transparent heart, evaluating and judging every motive, every thought for why we do what we do. And if we're to be honest with ourselves, oftentimes pride is a huge element of why we do what we do. Recognition is a huge element of why we do what we do. Remember, Jesus said, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, much less tell your neighbor or anyone else what you're doing for the Lord. Serve Him in sincerity and truth, and put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood. Now, many of us don't serve false gods. We don't have objects in our homes that we pray to, that we bow to, and that we make request of. But there are things in our lives that need to be put away, friends. Do you remember in the book of Acts, chapter 19, Paul is in Ephesus. Now, Ephesus served the great god Diana, and everyone who served Diana had an image, and they prayed to that image often. But Paul is preaching the message of Jesus, and as they forsake their false god Diana, it says in verse 18, many that believed came, and they confessed, and they showed their deeds. But notice verse 19, many of them also, which used curious arts, brought their books together, and they burned them before all men, and they counted the price of them, and found it 50,000 pieces of silver. Now, if you do the math on that, and I encourage you to do it, hold me accountable. If you do the math to that, today's value is $3.2 million. Now, that's a lot of money, friends. They loved Jesus. They wanted to honor Jesus to such a degree that they didn't think about the values of the possessions that they had that offended Jesus. But because now the Holy Spirit resides within them and darkness and light cannot coexist together, they chose to abide in the light and to forsake all forms of darkness. Now, friends, there's many of you that have DVDs and CDs, TVs and cell phones and other things that you use in a way that bring dishonor to God. And you would be better off to take those things in the backyard and set them on fire. Remember, Jesus told us you can't serve two gods. You can't have a foot in the world and a foot in the kingdom. You can't serve the world and serve Jesus. You can't be a part of the world and be a part of Jesus. You have to do what Joshua says here in verse 15. Choose today whom you will serve. Are you going to forsake everything, leave everything behind, and cling to Jesus, follow Jesus? Or are you going to remain dutiful to this world and deceive yourself by thinking that you're being obedient to Jesus? Remember, Jesus looked at someone and said, come and follow me. And that man looked at Jesus and said, my dad just died. I need to go and bury him. And Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Let the people of this world take care of such things. I'm calling you into a higher purpose. If Jesus puts following him before something that we would consider to be as important as burying our father, what do you think he thinks about your video games, your music, your TV choices, your movie choices, and other things that you invite into your life that dishonor him? So choose today whom you will serve, says Joshua. And the Spirit still cries, thousands of years later after Joshua, choose today whom you will serve. Because in verse 19, God is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not tolerate your spiritual adultery. And when you flirt with this world and the things of this world, and yet somehow deceive yourself into believing that you belong to him, friends, that is spiritual adultery. That's just like a man flirting with a woman at work and going home and telling his wife he loves her. No, if he loved her, he would not offer such flirtation to another woman. And that's what God is saying. If you truly love me, if you truly desire to serve me, then you must choose between the world in which you live and the kingdom which I offer. But if you choose the world, and you forsake the Lord in verse 20, and you serve the world, then God will turn and do you hurt. Many people wonder why bad things happen to good people. Well, maybe those people aren't as good as we think they are. Maybe we aren't as good as we think we are. And God is using these as forms of punishment and chastisement in our lives to get our attention because we're not 100% devoted to him in the way that we're living our lives and the choices that we're making. Well, after this final message that Joshua offers to the people, in verse 28 it says, Joshua let the people depart, every man unto his inheritance. At this point, the 12 tribes had been given parcels of land. And so everyone lived within their own tribe. And that's what this is saying. Every man departed to his own place. It came to pass after these things that Joshua, the servant of the Lord, died. And he was 110 years old when he died. They buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-serah, which is in Mount Ephraim on the north side of the hill of Gaash. And Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders that overlived Joshua, because they kept the word of God before the people. But you're going to see, after Joshua dies and these elders die, the people begin to wonder. They begin to take on the customs of the pagan nations around them, because those who should be passing on the story of God, the way God has worked among his people, the laws that he has given for them to live by, is not being passed on to future generations. And so at this point in our story, if you were going to think of things on a timeline, if this would be the creation, the ark would be here, Noah's ark, and the next monumental event would be where we're at now. Joshua dies. And everything that has happened from the ark through the life of Abraham, his descendants, through the life of Moses, and bringing the people out of captivity to where we are today in Joshua, and the death of Joshua, is a pivotal point to move us forward in the rest of the story. And that's where we'll pick up next time together, in the book of Judges. And this is an interesting time period in the history of the people of Israel. And there are a lot of stories throughout the book of Judges that we, as the followers of God, can benefit from in our daily walk with him. Well, friends, I'm so grateful again that you're with us. I pray the Lord Jesus will bless your day today. I pray that your heart will be full of joy, your mouth will be full of praise, and that you will keep your mind upon the things of God and not upon the things of this earth. Now, as he wills, and until next time, friends, I truly love you. I'll see you on the next video.